retired in Punta Cana, La Romana, but also a lot of Americans living in the DR, manufacturing plants, in the maquilas, the fruit zones that I mentioned before, many U.S. companies being represented in the DR. So the American Citizen Services in the DR, they're always very, very, very busy, especially 2.7 million of Americans visited the Dominican Republic, and when something happens, they have to provide assistance, and I've heard some stories. But still, it's a great tie. The numbers, U.S. experts, we already mentioned that, close to $8 billion. Again, I encourage you to be part of that pie. The Dominican Republic is the 43rd largest export market for U.S. goods. 43 out of the world, it's also impressive. U.S. imports, $4.7 billion, and that's because of the free trade zones. Remember I mentioned Haynes, Timberland, and the other manufacturing, and also the coal centers. The United States keeps still, you don't hear me well?
No, we can hear you, but you can walk a little bit.
Yeah, my voice, because I'm doing
not too far, but
three more of those. So by Friday, I'll have no voice. The United States still have a surplus in the trade with the Dominican Republic. Thank you, Paola, you're amazing. Any questions on that? Yes, sir.
Yes, can you talk a little bit more about tourism and the percentage of the economy, the GDP, that's related to tourism itself? It seems like it's a huge chunk of the economy that's related to tourism and tourism-related activities.
I don't have the exact figure, but I can tell you it's over 25% of the GDP. Tourism, it's been for a long time one of the pillars of the economy. And this is because, you know, it's an island with a not very well developed manufacturing industry. So when they talk about tourism, it's not only the dollars that arrive to the economy based on the payment of those tourists, but also the generation of the jobs, the food, because you have to provide for them, and the construction. So it's a whole macroeconomy within the economy of the Dominican Republic. If you want more details, I mentioned before the country commercial guide, or I can share with you some of the more detailed statistics. I don't know them from memory, but I can tell you that if you go, for example, to Punta Cana, it's like a different republic. In the past, we had 2, 3, 4 hotels there. Now, maybe over 200 hotels, just one just right after the other, all inclusive, with over 6 million tourists coming every year. It's the number one destination in the Caribbean. So it is a big industry. It's a big for the Dominican Republic. Any particular question you want on that, or? It is big. Are you in the sector?
I'm sorry?
Are you in the tourism sector? Or
I am not, but it just strikes me, and you mentioned the poverty level, the unemployment, and other things. Just wondering how much of that tourism dollar, the big dollar, gets recirculated into the Dominican Republic, and how much is offshore?
I understand where you're going. No, it does not go directly offshore, of course, part of it, but I'll tell you something. 15 years ago, that 32% was over 50 Dominicans living under the poverty line. Those areas where the Punta Cana is, or Casa del Campo, or Puerto Plata, were really depressed in the past. Now, if you go, there are vibrant economies, and that reflects, and then you see the GDP growing every year. The DR has been growing in the last probably 15 years. Doesn't mean, I mean, even the recession in the United States, even the recession in the area, the DR is growing. And one of the things that you have to thank is the tourism. It is indeed a generator of employment, wealth for the communities, and it's changing. For example, I want to mention that in Punta Cana, they're currently working with TSA to, in a pilot program. So when you fly from Punta Cana, from the United States to Punta Cana, it's like you're flying domestic. That's gonna happen soon. They're working on the details. So that was how big it is. We were expecting that to happen this year. It doesn't seem like it's going to, but they're working and putting everything in place. So I think that gives you an idea how important it is. You would not need to do immigration or customs. It's like flying here in the United States. I saw, yes, ma'am.
What about health tourism? It's growing too?
It's growing too. The DR is very well known for plastic surgery. It is not only for, but plastic surgery by far. When I flew, and this is true, when I flew from Miami, for some reason, they asked me for a wheelchair. So when I was waiting at the health issue that I had, I was waiting in the room in my wheelchair, and I'm not kidding, there were like six ladies like this with their girdle, and they were asking me, what you need? You need your and they were like, yeah. They flew from here, from the United States, to Santo Domingo to have their vitals. And also in Punta Cana, Hospitenda is a Spanish group, medical group. They have an amazing center there. And it's something that is growing. Not quite in the level that they were expecting, but it is. But plastic surgery, yeah, you go and they do you like in one day. Careful. No, it's true. I saw another, well, there was another lady that raised.
Yeah, no, I just recently came from Dominican Republic and I fell in love with the place. When I'm listening to you talk, and when I took a tour, they were educating us on how the kids at school, they would only go to school for 3 or 4 hours, but now the pro baseball players are providing the kids to go a full day, so the parents can work a full-time job.
Yes.
And it's mandatory for the children to learn three languages.
Yes.
And one school, it was an elementary school, then it became a high school, then it became a college, all in one day, one building. So I think that leads to what he was saying,
yes,
as far as the money being, you know,
relevant to
the people there.
You're right, and that's also a business opportunity. And what the gentleman was referring to is that the government is working on extended, schedule for kids. In the past used to be either 3 or 4 hours in the morning or 3 or 4 hours in the afternoon. Now that money that is going around, they're doing extended schedule for kids in most of the school. It's not fully implemented yet, but they're working on it. So kids receive breakfast, lunch, and help to do their homework in the afternoon and some snacks. So for example, I also cover everything related to food in the office. And there has been an increase of the, you know, micro companies, really small companies, and women-owned companies developing bread, food, cooking for those kids. We're talking about maybe 1 million students going to elementary schools in Santo, in Dominican Republic. So yeah, the money is going there as well. And thank you for your kind words. U.S. trade relations, we kind of talked about that a little bit already. Just want to add that besides the United States, the major trading partners for the Dominican Republic is Haiti, that's natural, Western Europe, and China. Other foreign direct investment, especially in the tourism, it's Spain, Canada, Mexico, and Japan. To answer some of the questions, oh yes sir, go ahead.
You mentioned that in the last 6 years, there's $23 billion invested by U.S. investors.
Yes sir.
Can you
tourism, and then the free trade zones.
I'm sorry?
Free trade zones. Tourism, number one, and second, free trade zones. And meaning companies, manufacturing, yeah, in the DR. Tourism is by far the largest. Yes. Hotels, not only at the beach, but also we have JW Marriott, Holiday Inn, Hilton, et cetera, et cetera. Yes, sir.
Yes. What's the percentage of NGOs versus private sector over there? Food business from the U.S. to Dominican?
NGOs?
Yes, for profits.
Yeah, I know what it is, but I would have to look into that. I don't have the answer to your questions. I'm sorry. If you email me, I can try to. From the top of my head, there are a few U.S. NGOs in the DR. Not many. There are mostly local, but the private sector is big. I think I would say that it's the comparison would be like maybe, I don't know, 90 against 10, maybe more. But I don't want to give you an answer. Just you allow me. Let's get, yeah, exactly. So to answer some of the questions in regards to the industry sectors, those are the leading sectors of the U.S. to the Dominican Republic in numbers. Hey, air conditioning and refrigeration equipment, 70% of the market is U.S., 27 million to the Dominican Republic, automotive parts and services, building products, hotel and restaurant equipment, medical equipment, answering lady question. No, sir, your question. That's the number there. Take a look, it's 192 million, significant. Total market is 350. Safety and security equipment and everything related to telecommunications, computers, and peripheral. In my 20 plus years in the commercial service, I would say that any product that is well conceived, well designed, and effectively merchandised, and represented in the country by a good local partner can be sold. However, it's important to mention that the DR is a market, as many of others in Latin America, that is quite price-oriented. Many cases, they will look into the price and then quality and after-sales services. We're really working on that. We're really promoting Made in the USA because USA is quality. With the years, people are starting to understand that if you pay peanuts, you get monkeys. If you pay $5 for a light bulb, just making that number, that is from China, for example, maybe it would last you 3 months, and then you would have to replace it. But if you pay $15 for one that is made in the United States, probably it's gonna last you 3 years. I've seen those. So people are understanding little by little. And now with the growing in the tourism sector, for example, where the quality is in demand, people are looking more into, you know, quality rather than the price. But still, you need to be competitive in order to be part of the Dominican market. Also, I would like to mention that related to the information and communication technology, the Dominican Republic, the government is working in providing the internet to at least capabilities to at least 70% of the population by 2020. We'll see details later, Republica Digital later. Currently, 80% of Dominicans have cell phones. In my house, we are 5, and we have 7 phones. And it is incredible how, like, for example, the help at home, instead of calling on the phone, now they WhatsApp me, come down, dinner served. So it's incredible. So that's probably something that is being replicated in every single moment in the Dominican Republic. Pharma, the public sector uses a lot of generics. There's somebody here with generics, that's a good opportunity as well.
Is that motivated by price?
By what?
Is that motivated by price?
Yes. Brief briefly want to mention two major infrastructure projects and opportunities that are happening currently in the Dominican Republic. The number one is the mobility, ground, transportation, and transit, and safety law. Dominican Republic, it's probably, that's something that's quite a challenge. Rank number two on accidents. We drive like crazy. And, yeah, but still, it's a fun place. That low, well, yeah, we've had some visitors that said that they're going to open a ride in Disney World since driving in Santo Domingo as part of Disney World. That law, basically what it does is that integrates everything related to public transportation and the system in the Dominican Republic. There used to be scattered in different agencies and ministries. Now the name is Intrant. They have even the traffic police, the logistic transportation from the ports, airports, into one agency that reports to the public. The Ministry of Public Works and Communications. That law, that project will generate, is generating $400 million in procurement, traffic lights, alarms, cameras, uniforms for the force, etc. If you're in that sector, it's good opportunity. The second project is Republica Digital. I mentioned before the 70% of internet coverage for the country. That's part of Republica Digital. It's a very, very ambitious project. $425 million in procurement. That will include not only the connectivity at home, but also school. The idea is to provide each student in the public school system with a computer and the teachers and have the content of their classes into that computer. The pilot is already in place. The government already bought 250,000 units of computers, personal computers. Our embassy is working really close and monitoring that everything is in the right place. Of course, the first batch of computers were American, US. Yes, sir.
Just a quick question for you. Is this presentation material, is this gonna be available for us, you know, after this is completed?
Yes, why not?
Okay.
Alan, are we gonna be sending the, or sharing the presentation with the audience? Absolutely, yeah, for sure. Just make sure that you leave us your, well, I'm sure you're registered. Yeah, okay.
I just have one more question. Yes, you mentioned as far as healthcare, there is there's a good split between commercial and private. Is there a Veterans Affairs
Is
there a Veterans Affairs presence in terms of like healthcare, like hospitals there?
Is there a what? Like
veterans.
Presence?
Veterans?
Yes.
Like no.
No?
No.
Okay.
It's just probably divided public and private, that's it. And then you go like children, but no veterans. No, we don't have that. We haven't fought any war.
Okay.
Just old people. Yes, ma'am.
Going back to the previous slide where you have every sector having a chunk of the market, what percentage or what?
The total market.
What dollar amount is allocated to the renewable energy industry?
I don't have it's not a leading sector. It's growing. Probably DR only have a couple of eolic wind parks operating. And solar panels, it's growing, but it's not significant to have it there. But there are opportunities, and people are starting to understand the importance of doing that, especially since we have the sun available all the time. Does that answer your question?
Yeah.
There are laws to incentive that. Yes, sir.
Yes. Back to the gentleman's question about Veterans Affairs. They do have the U.S. Veterans Center in Santiago.
Oh, I didn't know that.
That's the only one in the Dominican Republic.
Oh, you see?
That's in Santiago. I'm retired Air Force. And
but
I
U.S. veterans.
U.S. veterans, U.S. military veterans, they They created a center so they can take advantage of the benefits that are here in the United States. So they can do their taxes, they can do whatever they need to do that they will be able to do here in the United States. But it's a small center, but it's growing.
I mean, U.S., not the
United States. Yes, United States.
Okay.
There was a reason why I was asking that, because I just
know. I didn't know that, sir. That's great information.
There was a reason why I was asking that, thank you, because I was curious to know if there was any information on veteran population in the Republic.
But U.S. veterans,
yes,
you mean?
U.S. veterans, like in terms of like population of communities.
Maybe American Citizen Services, that's part of the consulate. I'm sure they do. I mean, not all American that lives in the DR is registered at the consulate. Some of them just go there and live for a specific period of time.
Okay.
I can do that. We can get in contact, and I can ask my colleagues at the consulate if they have that information.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I didn't know that. Yes, ma'am.
How is the cruising industry?
It's growing. Carnival is present in the North Bar and some, I mean, U.S., and in the South, Europeans are pretty active. It is growing, but not quite as it should be. They're working on dredging the ports and making all the facilities to try to increase that. Mm-hmm. Carnival is the only American. He was first.
I work with contractors and builders.
Uh-huh.
What is the, I guess, rule or policy with land acquisition, meaning would I, if you were a resident of Dominican Republic, would I have to like marry you to actually buy the land and then build on it? I'm just saying. next life. How does that work exactly? Because I know in like Bahamas and other places, you can't buy outside.
You can buy land even if you're not Dominican.
Okay.
No problem with that.
Okay.
Just make sure that you go securing your title, that everything is in place. That's something that the U.S. government, we've been working very close to the Dominican government and making sure that all the registrations and the titles for the lands are in the proper place.
Okay.
Just make sure that you are buying something with a legal title. But
so I could build my vacation home?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
The blue flag. You have the, looks like the other one, sir. The medical equipment market is very big important in the Dominican Republic. There are any special assets there or tax exemptions for U.S. startups in the Dominican Republic market?
Want to get into that very quick. Any other question? Yes, sir.
Yeah, I have one specific perspective on the level of infrastructure, the percentage of homes that telephone service or internet service, the penetration in mobility, and electrical service in homes. Do you have any ideas what percentage have those things?
I don't have the percentage, but electricity, it's a big issue.
It is
a big issue in the Dominican Republic.
Mm-hmm.
They calculate that at least 40% of the Dominicans are in need of housing. Okay, and what was the penetration? Currently, it's 59. They're looking into 70 for 2020.
For
internet penetration. I already mentioned that 80% of Dominicans have cell phones. So yeah, it's quite significant. And answering some of the questions that I mentioned before, I'm gonna touch this briefly. On the taxes and tariff, the Dominican Republic is part of the free trade agreement between the United States and Central America, along with other countries like El Salvador, Honduras, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, and Guatemala. That provides U.S. manufactured products, a tremendous advantage in exporting because they don't pay tariff. It's something that we would have to check on an individual basis. The only articles and merchandise manufactured in the U.S. that still have some quotas is everything related to ag, because they were able, the local Dominican local production, they were able to negotiate that. But for example, most of the medical equipment, they don't pay tariffs when entering into the Dominican Republic. The agreement has been in place since 2007, so it already had the 10 years of phasing the quotas. Very few remain, I think milk, meat, etc. But still, the tariffs are low, and also Captain ER has helped the Dominican Republic to have a more transparent and more level playing field. Right, figures, we already talked about that with Florida. Take a look. That's impressive. Bilateral trade, $12 billion. Florida exported approximately $3 billion to the Dominican Republic. And as I always said, we have more than hurricane paths in common. It's a great trade. The commodities that represent the most, total merchandise. Look at the rand, 7, 5, 8, and 10. Cotton yarn is for the maquilas, textiles, automotive, ICT, medical, telecommunications, safety and security, plastics, and cosmetics and cosmetics. I would say that those are important ones. But not everything is nice. There are challenges, lack of transparency, first corruption, rule of law, there have been some issues about it, access of financing, entrenched competition, we already mentioned that, IPR, just make sure that you're protected, and if you go with a local partner, you have everything registered. The world business ranking is not bad for a small country. Any questions on that? No? So I think that after everything we've seen, I'm almost convincing you to go to the trade mission. I'll be the general coordinator for the trade mission. Also, I'm covering some of the industry sectors that we mentioned before. I encourage you to go. Please fill out your applications. We will review your application. We'll have a conference call with you, my colleagues at the office, and we will let you know either your products or services have potential in the DR or not. We try to save you time. And also, we cannot guarantee that you'll be doing business the first day, but if you're interested in the market, and I can see that, please go. There are opportunities, and the DR could be the entrance to the Caribbean region. Lastly, I want to leave you with what we do. Commercial service, we can help you not only with trade issues like this one, we can do trade counseling, that is free. There's a lot of market intelligence free. Like I was saying, if I don't know the answer, at least most of the times I know where to find it or let you know where to find it. Business matchmaking, trade issues like this one, we do trade shows in the US, etc. Thank you very much for being here. That's my contact information. Please take a picture so I don't have enough business cards. There's a question. Yes, sir?
I just want to make a comment. One of the challenges that you have there with regards to local financing from banks in the Dominican Republic, that's true, but there are a lot of institutions outside of the Dominican Republic that
use
the government programs like EXIM and
SBA. We have somebody from EXIM. So thank you very much for being here. My number at the embassy, my email, so the presentation. Thank you very much for being here.
Santo Domingo to make this informative presentation. Before I talk about general services programs and trade grants from Enterprise Florida, I would like to introduce to you my colleague Alejandra. She will be the one organizing the Home Republic mission, and
she came from U.S. Commercial Service in Colombia. She really know what's going on here, and she's the one to really for you to get to know and tell you a little bit more about the upcoming November mission. Please.
Thank you, John. Good morning.
Good morning.
So for this trade mission, we have, it's going to be a three-day trade mission. We're going to, the delegation will depart on November the 13th. And that day we're going to have a welcome reception. And then the next day on November the 14th, we're going to have the one-on-one appointments, which is the Gold Key service. It's a matchmaking service that we...
Can you hear me now?
It's a lot of closer.
Okay. Did you hear what I said first?
No.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, so it's a three-day trade mission. The delegation leaves Florida on the 13th, and that day in the afternoon we will have a welcome reception. That reception will be just the Florida companies, the U.S. Commercial Service staffs, and maybe some other people from the Dominican government. Then on Wednesday, November the 14th, we're gonna start with the matchmaking meetings, the one-on-one meetings. That's the Gold Key service, and that's the appointments that we coordinate jointly with the U.S. Commercial Service, which is our colleague Sheila, that you already know very well. And we're gonna, we start with a breakfast briefing. That's gonna be done by the staff from the U.S. Embassy in Santo Domingo. So you will have representatives from the political section, the economic section, the commercial section, the office of regional security office, speaking a little bit more about the Dominican Republic, political environment, the economy, all these key facts that you need to know when doing business in a given country. Then we will start with the matchmaking meetings all day. That will be probably around from 9 to 5. And then we go to the reception at the ambassador's residence. The ambassador to the Dominican Republic is actually from Pompano. So she's very excited to have us in Santo Domingo. To be her very first trade mission in the post. So she's very much looking forward to this trade mission. And then on Thursday, November 15th, we have a half day of matchmaking meeting. And then the afternoon is off for any follow-ups that you can want.